Father, we thank you so much for this morning. We thank you so much for the opportunity that we have together, the opportunity to honor you, to love you. Father, we just pray that you'll inhabit the service, that you will fill us with your love. And Father, help us to just honor and adore you this morning through our singing, through our praise, through our worship of you. We pray all this in your Son's name. Amen. Children's church, I think we've gone.
Please stand.
Christ the Christian one.
Did you feel the people tremble? Did you hear the singers roar? When the lost began to sing of Jesus Christ the Savior.
Thousands elsewhere. There is one day in your
see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells. There is one thing in your voice, there is one thing in your house, there is one thing in your voice, thousands elsewhere. There is one thing in your house, there is one.
2,000 years ago, because of your love, you sent your son. Jesus Christ to the cross. This morning, as we come to this table in remembrance, take the bread that represents the broken body, and the fruit of the vine represents the blood that was spilled. All of this is your love. We do this in remembrance of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In love we come. In thankfulness we come. Humbly we come. Thank you for your love. Pray all this in Jesus' name.
Let's return to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for all the gifts and the abilities that you give us and all the blessings. We ask that you take this offering that we give back so that we can use it to spread your word throughout the world. In your Son's most precious name we pray.
Afterwards, he said, I've got to let you go. I can't have that. The guy's like, please, 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 please. it was just a, I just failed. And he said to the director, have you ever failed before? The director said, well, yeah. He said, so I need another chance. He said, okay, give me another chance. The next night, he's portraying it. He's at the point where he's carrying the cross through the town, and the same man starts heckling him. Ah, that's not heavy. You can't believe that that's heavy. I mean, come on. You know, get him a real cross. Let him carry something real. In the middle of the streets, Jesus dropped his cross, went over and punched the man. The director's like, I don't know what to do with you. What am I going to do with you? You can't be acting like this. And he said, the guy just gets to me. He said, but I think I've got a way to block it. I mean, I'll block it. He said, well, okay. He said, but this is it. This will be 3 strikes, you're out. He said, we'll do it. I said, okay. The next night he gets all the way through. He's hanging on the cross, wincing in pain as you do, and the heckler goes, that's the best you got? I mean, you don't even look like you're hurt. And he's going, and Jesus said from the cross, you wait till the resurrection, I'll take care of you. So you get those ideas. I traveled for Kentucky Christian University for 3 years as a recruiter, and we do summer programs, and in the summer programs, we did a thing called Way of the Cross. And my role in the Way of the Cross was to carry the cross down the road. It was 6 different scenes of meeting Jesus where he is. We did it probably 10 years ago or so here. It was the last time you were here before you moved back, Gary. And I think you were the Jesus washing the feet, right?
Mm-hmm.
It takes something to do that, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, when you get into that role, you do that. So I was the Jesus that carried the cross down the road. And we always did it on Friday night before the kids went home Saturday morning to try and make an impact with their lives. And everything went good. I was at Lake Region Christian Assembly up in northern Indiana. And it was close enough that my mom and dad had come and were there. And my mom said, when you came around the corner carrying that cross, she just lost it. You know, that can't be. Well, the next morning, after that's over, we tried to make the impact Friday night. That's over. Some of us counselors that were there were just horsing around. And I remember a little girl coming up to me and saying, gosh, that's different. I said, what's different? She said, I never would have thought Jesus would have acted like that. And we weren't doing anything bad. We were just horsing around. But she remembered me from the night before in that role. And so today I want to talk to you about stepping stones or stumbling blocks. Now, if you turn to Philippians chapter 3, be our main scripture, Philippians chapter 3. Verses 15 through 19. Philippians chapter 3, verses 15 through 19. Reads like this. Therefore, let us, as many as are mature, have this mind. And if in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal even this to you. Nevertheless, to the degree that we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us be of the same mind. Brethren, join me in following my example, and note those who so walk as you have us for a pattern. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now I tell you even weeping, that these are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who set their minds on earthly things. And so what we want to look at is the characteristics here that they show of a stumbling block or a stepping stone. Now, a stumbling block, so that you know what there are, they had, back in those days, 2 different types of grinding things. They had a small one, a millstone, they called it, that a lady could take and have her thing and mill up some flour in a pot. They also had large ones. Large ones so large that we couldn't turn them, but it takes hooking up donkeys to walk in a circle and grind the grain and stuff like that. And Jesus had come out and said in a place, it is better for you to have a millstone around your neck. A millstone around your neck. Now, he's not talking that little pot. He's not talking that little thing that she cried with. He's talking about a millstone tied around your neck and thrown into the sea. Then to defile him. Mark 9, 42 and 43 says, but whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to stumble, it would be better for him to have a millstone hung around his neck and he be thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life maimed rather than having two hands and go to hell, into the fire that shall never be quenched. So he's telling you it's better to have things done to you than to be wrong, to lead someone astray, to be a stumbling block. So when we look at it, we want to look at the characteristics of a stumbling block. What are the characteristics of a stumbling block? A stumbling block looks for its own self. Read it there. He starts off by saying, you are an enemy to the cross. If you're an enemy to the cross, who's number one in your life? Right here. Who's leading you in that life? Probably Satan. Because you're all about me. Do you see the me system in the world today? I mean, when you go out and you look at things, the me. It's all about me. What can I get from it? You know, I've even had people in church say, well, when I ask them, can you help out this program? Well, what's in it for me? Now, when they say that, I get taken back. I'm like, I don't know, salvation, a jewel in your crown. It's hard to answer that question. What's in it for me? I mean, I don't know. What are you going to put into it? You know, I've always been told by my dad that you only get as much out as you put in. You know, so what are you going to put into it? That's what you'll get. And what do you get from Christ? Someone said it, salvation. We get His love. We get the Holy Spirit. We get, I mean, there's a lot that we get from God because of it. I mean, we look at it and it's like, what's in it for me? That just rubs wrong because every week I tell you, it's not about me. It's not about you. It's about what? God. It's about what He needs and He wants to better His kingdom here. It's about us putting our best foot forward for Him. It's not becoming an enemy of the state. So verse 18 says, for many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ. I mean, it brings Paul to tears that he's got to tell them, and there are these people out there. There are these people in here. There are these people who become an enemy to the cross. An enemy to the cross. If you think Sunday morning is all you need, you're probably an enemy to the cross. If you're not opening your Bible daily and reading and taking in and becoming more like Christ, probably an enemy of the cross. If you're not in a relationship with God and loving Him and Him loving you and you doing what God wants you to do, He is the Lord, we are the servant. If you don't see that role, you're probably an enemy of the cross. Because it takes a whole lot more than 1 hour here to be a stepping stone. I mean, just 1 hour here, you're not going to know enough when someone asks you, what do you believe? You're not going to have an answer for it. It's going to be like, oh, on Sunday morning they said what? You remember the words in the songs you just sung? You You remember what you were saying to Jesus in those songs? I mean, it's that. It's that level of, I'm yours, you're mine. We don't want to be an enemy to the cross. The second part of it is, we read it, driven by fleshly appetites. It says driven by their belly. Any of you driven by your belly? That seems to be a big thing, right? But what does he mean by driven by their belly? Driven by their appetite of this life. Driven by what they... I mean, gluttony is what? Sin. Fornication is what? Lying is what? They're all there, I mean... But we're driven by that. We don't care who we hurt as long as I get up that ladder, as long as I get better. We're driven by our belly. And our belly can lead us in some places we don't want to go. But we let it run us and deliver us. Paul says, the God of stumbling block is the belly. Paul is saying it's someone who professes to be a Christian is more concerned with satisfying the desires of their flesh than they are the desires of God. You put other things before God. Your belly. The third part of it that we look at is stumbling blocks are focused on just the world. Focused on just the world. That means I need a new car to keep up with what they got. I need a bigger house because it's a status symbol. I need. What do you need? Jesus. And what do you get with Jesus? Everything. Now when we say that, we're not saying he's going to give you a mansion. He's going to give you what you can handle. He's going to give you what you really need. I mean, I looked at an ad the other day, and I thought, I need that. And the ad was advertising a 38-ounce steak. Talk about belly driven. A 38-ounce steak. And if you could eat the whole steak and the meal goes with it in 30 minutes or less, it's free. I said, that's me. Now this morning, I was looking through things and CC's Pizza has put out a challenge. A 28-inch large pizza eaten in less than an hour, and they will give you $500. I'm like, Dawn says, that's probably more difficult to do than it looks. I said, it's CC's. It's the paper thin crust. It's the, I mean, surely.
Well, you'll get it.
Yeah, probably they'll give you that. They'll give you crust this deep. I told Dawn, man, that 500 is fine. I wouldn't even attempt it. Now, if I was 20 years old, maybe. You know, but my appetite anymore is a little bit. But those things that the world throws to us, they entice us. You know, you do this and we'll give you that. And you're thinking, well, maybe. I mean, stop. Whose are you? Whose are you? And what do you really need? I mean, I could sit there at my house and I could look at the property that I have around me. I could look at the fields and trees. I can look at the house, the stuff in the house, the stuff around the house, the stuff in the barn, the stuff everywhere. And you're chuckling because you're just like that, aren't you? I mean, I have more than I need. I mean, Joe Connor brought all this stuff next door over here. He's moving. He is a handyman and had all stuff, and he said, if I take the tools with me, people want me to work. So he just brought everything here, and he dumped it next door, and he said, you know, let people get what they need. So we're like, And last week, a bunch of people got what they needed, and there's still shovels and rakes and hoes, and there's buckets full of sprinkler system, if you have a sprinkler system to fix those, beds, and all kinds of. And there's a bunch of stuff over there, and just go help yourself.
Not now, Carol.
Not now, Carol. Don't be there. There are three generators back there, but they're in disrepair. Someone's going to look at them and take care of those. A couple were spoken for, there's still like one there. So, something like that. But I mean, it's just stuff that he said, if I take it, they won't be using it. So here, he's decluttering. He's going from, which kills me, a 15-room house and 11 sheds to a single-wide mobile home. He says, I'm done working. I'll do other things. So they're there. I mean, and when you look at the trailers he kept bringing full of stuff, I'm thinking, my gosh, look at all the. If I was to do that,
maybe just with that.
I could feel it. I could. Mike, you feel me?
I didn't say broke.
I mean, it's just that way. We have more than we need, but we see stuff and think, oh, I got to have it.
Tools don't count.
Keep preaching. And if they're motor driven, oh, they'll count it off. You can never know this one. But we focus so much on the world that we forget about God. I mean, ministers have a problem. Sometimes we do this. We get so bent on doing the work that we forget about God. You can get so busy doing the work and doing the stuff that you forget, hey, I got to feed myself. I do those things. Gary said to me this morning, well, since you've been gone a few Sundays, we're really looking forward to some real good stuff. I asked him, man, you must have a fever. You're talking sick stuff. You know? It's good to get away. It's good to see how other places are doing some things, but it's always good to get home, isn't it? When you're home, out of the world, here with God's people, with doing things that we know God wants us to do. I mean, that's what it's about. It's not about what's out there. What is a stepping stone? Gary got up here a little bit ago and did communion meditation. He said, gosh, the band stole my thunder. Well, welcome to my world. Because the same verses are the verses I was going to use today, the same that we saw on the screen, the same that he read. And so, and that you get them in your head, you've seen them, you've heard them. I asked Gary if he would, at this point, read them to you again. Listen real close to the words he's saying.
1 John 4, verses 7 through 10. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins.
So do you get that? What does God do for us? He loves us. And because he loves us, he's willing to do what?
Forgive.
He's willing to give us salvation. He is willing to send his Son. That's given everything he had. Understand those words. Because God loved you. Now look at you. Look at you in the mirror. Look at you in your life. God loves that. In spite of some things you do, God loves you. In In spite of some things you might say, God loves you. In spite of you hurting Him and sinning against Him, God loves you. We can't understand that level of love. I mean, someone says something against me. I mean, here this guy dropped his cross, went and slept. And we don't understand that love, and if we're going to portray that love, if we're going to be like that, then we have to be the stepping stones. Another word for stepping stone I put in here is ambassador. What's an ambassador? A representative. Someone who speaks for. Ken was an ambassador. He represented a country. He went to the UN and he spoke for them. I mean, he brought their wishes or their desires or thoughts to the UN, right? Did they listen to you?
Listen, but maybe not do.
Listen, but maybe not do. That's exactly what I was hoping you'd say. Because you're sitting here today and you're listening, but maybe you won't. We have a God who listens and answers. It may not be the answer you want, it may not be the direction you want, but He answers. He's a God who will do those things, and He has put His faith in us. And I was putting this together this week, and I had to step back and say, God put His faith in me to make sure that this morning you hear Him. That means get me out of the way that His Word can speak to you, that you understand that He loves you. That He wants you to be an ambassador for Him. 1 Corinthians 5:20 talks about us being ambassadors of Christ. Meaning that we are extremely important, responsible in our lives and the way we live, that God can count on us to be there for Him. Ken's country counted on him to be there at the UN. Not out doing something else somewhere else. They sent him there to do a job and to do that. And God has placed that on and you hear me say this a lot. You're not here by mistake. You're here today to hear this message because God brought you here for this purpose. And He wants you to know that He loves you and He backs you, but He needs you. Stepping stone. What is a stepping stone? An ambassador, a representative, a person who goes before to tell about what's there. And in order to be His ambassador, we learn in the scripture that we have to, Paul says, follow my example. Okay? Follow my example, he says. What example was Paul? Pretty good. Paul, once he met Christ, changed his life so drastically to be a different person. He is a good example to follow. We have the best example. We have Jesus Christ who, being God, came to earth as human and lived to be that example for us to show us how we could live. I mean, it is doable. The God who loves us sends His Son to us to give us an example, to show us that we can live this kind of life that He's talking about if we desire it. Question is, do you desire it? Do you want to be a stepping stone? A stepping stone is someone who is used for others to walk on. Well, I don't want people to walk on me. Not in that sense. You're the path for them to follow to get to the desired destination that they want to be at. What's the desired destination? Becky, you're 80 years old. What's your desired destination? The only Becky in an IU shirt that's here. What's your desired destination? When all life is done, you want to be where? Heaven. Sydney's told her. Come on, baby. That's our desired destination. Heaven. It's tough when you're 80. Understand. But our desired destination is heaven. And so if I am going to be a stepping stone, I am going to create a path for you to walk on to get to that destination, heaven. Now, in order for me to do that, I have to be it first. I can't lead you to where I don't know you're going. I have to the desire to be His. I have to have the desire to live for Him. I have to have the desire to be His ambassador, to spread the word and to create that path that you can follow. That I could say, follow me. Paul's pretty bold, follow me. If I wrote that, I'd probably say, follow me most of the time. Know what I mean? There's those times. Gary, you ever have one of those times?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, don't follow Gary on certain days.
That's right.
Yeah. We all have those times. I sat here Wednesday night and talked for an hour and a half with Mike and Tracy after a Bible study. I had said in Bible study, we're all sinners. And after that conversation, I said, I have to change my vocabulary. Because sitting in this room, we are not sinners. We are saints. I'm a saint. I have a Savior who died for me that I have accepted as my Lord and Savior, and He has made me a saint. Now, do I fall? Sometimes. But I'm not a sinner because I have forgiveness. I am able to have God forgive me of that and be back to where He'd have me be so that I can come up here this morning and say, here's what God has for you. Here's what God has for you. You are a saint. How should a saint live? What's the example? Well, we have a God. You already read about it. Who loves us. Who loves us to the point that He is willing to send an ambassador, Jesus, to us. That He might be the stepping stone to lead us in the direction that we need to go. And all we have to do is, like Paul, follow. Follow what? The example set before us. Follow the example of Christ as He lived. Follow the example that we would answer the way He would answer, that we would do what He would do. I mean, we don't condemn people. We set them straight and tell them, go and sin no more. Otherwise, we ourselves would be condemned. I mean, we have to start looking at what are we and who are we. And most importantly, whose are we? I am Tracy. I'm the son of Tom and Jackie Hansen, but I am a saint in the kingdom of Christ. I am now an ambassador for my Lord and Savior to be a stepping stone and a path to you. So that you can get to your desired destination at the end of this life. And if I don't lay the path, the stepping stones straight, I'm a coward. That day of judgment, God is going to ask me, what did you do and why? If I didn't do it right. Not just me. You're sitting here this morning, and I would say 99% of you have professed Christ as your Lord and Savior. And so you're accountable. It would be better for you to have a millstone tied around your neck and thrown into the water than to do it wrong. wrong. When we talk, there's times I don't take communion. We talked about it Wednesday night. There's times I don't take communion. If my mind is not right on that morning, on Sunday when we're serving it, I don't take it. I can go home later when my mind's right and get a piece of bread and juice, and me and God can have our moment together, and I can take that. Because you don't want to take that unworthily. Scripture says, take it unworthily, you're eating and drinking damnation to yourself. How many of you want that? Well, here he's talking about living the life the way that it should, or you, if you do it wrong, he uses the word there, hell. Okay, our desired destination, as Becky told us, is heaven. The other destination is hell. And if we are not being the ambassadors that God desires for us to be, if we are not laying the stepping stones in a straight line for others to follow, we're going to be in trouble. We're going to have issues. We are a light unto the world, a lamp unto the people. I mean, we are for them to see so that they can see a difference in us. I mean, we're not even, as Scripture tells us, of this world. We're just passing through. This is not my home. My home is where Becky's saying in heaven. I mean, this is just the test. Are you his? Are you living the life that he wants for you? The second part of stepping stone is you have to be focused. Focused. Don't take your eyes off. Focused. What are we to be focused on? God. Heaven. The spiritual things. A horse is out plowing, they have a tendency to put blinders on. Why do they put blinders on?
Keep them forward.
Keep them focused. Keep them from getting distracted from some things on the side so that the plow lines go straight. So they can lay in their crops. And in this world, we Christians need to make sure we have our blinders on. Don't look at the things left and right that Satan's throwing out at you, trying to distract you. Stay focused on your goal. Stay focused on him that can get you there. Stay focused on God. Stay focused on his love for you. Stay focused on those things that will drive you to that final destination. Because it is so easy to get burdened down with all these little things of life that we never get to living for Christ. Our goal, be Christian. Definition of Christian, little Christ's. To be just like Jesus. He came and lived and showed the example that it could be done. We can do it if our desire is there. If we focus ourselves, if we be his. If we understand the fact that we are ambassadors. That when I walked that aisle and gave my life to Jesus, those words that Paul echoes, I no longer live. Christ lives in me. It's no longer what I want. It's what does he want. It's no longer what should I do. It's what will he have me to do today. And we have to do that everywhere we are. We have different jobs. We have different titles. We have different roles that we play. And in those jobs and titles and roles, we have to be Christ. We have to show others. We have to direct them. We have to lay our path before them. Don't follow them. Follow Christ. Don't be distracted. Follow Christ. stay focused where you have to be. Now, the question for today is simply this. Look at your life. Only you can see it all. And I have things rolling in my head right now that I did as a kid and stuff like that that you don't know. You don't know. I have things in my head rolling around right now that took place this week. You'll never know. They're mine. But I can look at my life and I can answer the question, are you a stepping stone or a stumbling block? See that actor in the beginning I told you about, man, what a stepping stone to portray Christ and to get people to understand what he did for them and then to blow it by punching out the guy. To blow it. To portray Christ carried across down the road, and the next morning a little girl says, I didn't know Jesus would do that. Literally. It wasn't anything big. We were just, you know how guys are shoving each other around. It was just a, I don't even remember exactly what's going on. I remember those words she said. It was like, we did exactly what we wanted to. We brought him to the cross last night. Today we destroy the cross. And we can't live like that. We bring them to the cross, we gotta show them the cross. Not just the cross, but show them the man from the cross. Get them to understand and know him and love him the same way that we do. In your life every day, ask yourself, stumbling block or stepping stone? By pushing them away or bringing them to the saving grace of God. So we're going to stand and sing, and if you have a decision to make, that you look at your life. Maybe you need to talk to God today and say, God, you gave me opportunities and I blew it. Help me to be a better stepping stone in life to lead you to be. Maybe you have to ask for forgiveness of being that stumbling block that has kept people from knowing you. Maybe this morning you need to just be his. To accept him as your Lord and your Savior for the first time in his life. We offer you to be able to come and to talk to us and to accept him as Lord and Savior. Maybe it's you're sitting where you are and you've heard this and now you've got a decision to make. Am I his? Am I going to live every day for him? Am I going to be a stepping stone for his kingdom? Whatever your decision, as we stand and as we sing, we make the choice. Addie. She smiled once we said it. Pretty smile. So we'll have it for Addie, and next Sunday you'll have a little list in your bulletins that tells you some sizes and some types of diapers, stuff like that. Because it's tough when you're, Addie, how old are you?
I don't know. 72.
It's tough when you're 72 and you become a father for like a newborn.
Tough. I like that she thumbs up.
So anyway, we are going to help them out a little bit if you guys are willing to do that. That afternoon on the 20th, right after church, we'll have some hamburgers, hot dogs up here and have a little luncheon and do that for them. So, all right? We'll do hamburgers, hot dogs, and drinks. And if you want to bring something to go with that, you are more than welcome to do that. So that'll be the 20th, 2 weeks from today. Anything else we missed? Anything else? Gary, you want to close us in prayer?
Sure. Father, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your presence and your understanding, your forgiveness, the salvation you promised through Jesus. Be with us now as we go our separate ways and watch over us as we walk with you each and every moment. We ask this in Jesus' name, our risen Lord and Savior. Amen.